Civilization.
Beg your pardon?
I've traveled 8,000 miles across the burning desert without food or water for 10 long weeks. And then at last I saw your car parked there and I knew the end of my journey was in sight.
It's not our car, actually. It's his brother's car.
At first, I thought it was a mirage.
No, it's a Humber. It's 8 years old. Isn't it
nice. Please, I just want some water, please, just some water.
Oh, we haven't any water. We've got some tea, like a cup of tea, love.
Yes, please, please, anything, anything.
Oh, there's a bit of coffee left if you prefer coffee.
Anything, anything.
I mean, just say, which would you prefer?
Oh, no, Fizzy Pop would be better for him than coffee if he's just come across desert.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, we drank all the Fizzy Pop, remember, yeah.
We didn't drink it all, did we?
Yes, we did in that lay-by outside Leicester.
Oh. Please, please.
Well, what would you like then, love? Tea or coffee?
Tea.
Now, are you sure? You're not just saying that.
Tea.
Coffee's just as easy.
Oh, come on, love. I think he said tea.
Tea!
Oh, there he goes again.
Oh, well, then, you'd like a cup of tea. Right.
Yes,
listen. Yeah, you don't mind drinking out of the top of the thermos, do you? Because we only brought the two cups with us, you see.
I don't care. I drink out of my bare hands.
Oh, we wouldn't dream of that. Now, don't go away. I won't be a minute.
Here, I say, don't know whether United won, do you?
Look, I've been in the desert for 10 weeks.
Ah, it's all there and all. They haven't won a match since January.
Oh, yes, what part of the desert were you in?
I don't know.
Oh, well, do you take sugar?
No, just the tea, the liquid.
Because, you know, if you'd come earlier, you could have had sausages and pork sandwiches.
Oh, yes, you could. Here you are, nice cup of tea, love. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, dear.
There, it's all over him now. Look at that. No, it's all right, lad. It wasn't your fault. You set yourself
did he dirty your shirt? Oh, I'll get a cloth.
I can't bear it.
Hello. He's gone.
Thank goodness. Even the Sahara's getting crowded nowadays.
Oh, hello there. Last week, you remember, I was showing you how to make a bed for your roses. Well, this is what it looks like when complete. All nice and tucked in there, you see. Do remember, a rose by any other name would be a carrot. Or a cauliflower. Now, this little plant here is a man-eater. And you must be tremendously careful when you're feeding your man-eaters. Just give them a handful of peat. Or Fred. Over the last few years in the garden, scientists have advanced by leaps and bounds. Here you can see some scientists advancing by leaps and bounds. They're trying to avoid the vegetable beds. Well, what have they come up with? Well, they've weed killer for those of you who don't like weeds. And for those of you who do, they've got flower killer. And they've come up with this latest weapon in the war against weeds, the Thompson submachine gun. And this new aerosol can insect killer, which will kill any known type of insect. For example. You can kill any insect that way. And they've also got this new flower pot, which can be used this way for the impression of a small plant, or this way for the impression of Tommy Cooper. That's funny. And there's this hoe for moving hay called a hay-hoe. And for scaring away the birds, scientists have perfected this new scarecrow. That should keep the birds off your bulbs. Incidentally, if you planted these bulbs, you should be fine. If you planted these bulbs, you should have your head examined. They need far too much light. But my particular favourite is a plant that'll keep you happy for hours. They're almost human. They do require feeding. I give this one steak and chips, egg and chips, omelettes, that sort of thing, and they're terribly affectionate, and they make a really wonderful companion. Just one thing, though, you must remember to water them frequently. Bye for now.
All right, hold the back page, okay?
City editor.
Yeah?
I've got a great story for you.
Oh, yes?
It's a great story.
All right, let's hear it.
Once upon a time in the land of the wobbly dum-dum tree, Ricky the gobbly pixie sat beneath the magic oak tree.
That's enough! I'm not interested in fairy stories. This is a newspaper. Miss Perkins, will you show this lunatic out of here?
But I haven't finished.
Come away at break of day to Fairyland, to the golden shores of Fairyland. I will lead you, my
friend. Last week, the evil Mrs. Black, disguised as Mrs. White, the nice housekeeper, flummoxed Captain Fantastic with a huge meal. Now she is free to purpose her evil pursuances. Will she find her magic ring? Black magic! Mrs. White is planting an evil handbag tree. Obviously from the old proverb, from little purses, mighty handbags grow. Oh dear.
This is Captain Fantastic speaking. After such a big meal, it was time for my morning institutional. And before you could say Jack Robinson, I'd run right round the house and done all my exercises.
Jack Robinson.
Hang on a minute. There's a lack of changing facsimiles.
Ta-da.
Here you go. Ha-ha. Now to do some exercises. Oh, hello, Brody. You feel a bit heavy this morning? Oh, just stand yourself up. What's the matter with you? All right, lay down. Tired beast. This dumbbell I'd picked up was obviously waiting for a lift. Got myself trapped. Go, get out there. Get my legs out now. Take up weightlifting for. I can never pick the things up. I have to use my brolly to get up.
Meanwhile, the plot was ripening. Mrs. Black's blooming bag bush is begging for a bevy. Water pity it's not on tap. But her evil instinct tells her to follow her hose. Get out of that fantastic weight, Captain Dumbbell.
Good to get the weight off me feet. Hello, that looks like a bag oak. But what's that? That's obliviously a water snake. A dreaded boar constructor. But I'd wrestle with it and kill it. Here I tea time. What's more, time for tea. Well, I better clear this up. Can't leave that dangerous hose pipe hanging about. I'll just give it a tug and wrap it up. Now to give it a heave.
Has Captain Fantastic gone too far this time? See next week's pipe cleaning episode of Captain Fantastic.
Good evening, and welcome to Going for a Burton, an antique quiz game. Well, let's get started with the first object that I have here, and there it is. It'll come up on the screen for you now what it is for the people at home, and I'm going to hand this one, first of all, to Professor Hart to tell me what he thinks of that.
Well, it's probably Egyptian. 12th, 13th century. Yes, it's very tasteful, yes. Now, I think it's porcelain from the 18th century, imported.
Yes, I see. Well, of course, you're very close, so I am going to give it to you. There you are. It is, in fact, a loaf of bread.
Ah, yes, of course, I thought so.
You thought what?
I thought it was porcelain from the 18th century.
Yes, but it's not.
Absolutely, it's not.
No.
But I thought so.
Yes. So, well, we'll move straight on to the next object, and which I have here. Can you all see that at home? Can you see that? Is it coming up on your screens? Yes, it is. And now I'm going to pass this one over to Sir Charles to tell me what he thinks of that. Sir Charles, what do you make of that?
Yes, well, I mean, this is obviously a Victorian hunting bowl. Very well made. I should think it would probably make a good exhibit on anyone's sideboard.
Yes, it's Victorian hunting bowl.
Definitely, definitely. Yes,
would you be surprised if I told you it was, in actual fact, a plate of egg and chips?
All a plate of egg and chips.
Yes. Would you put a price on it for us?
Yeah, I'd say somewhere in the region of £500, something like that.
A little more definite.
3 and 6.
Yes. Now let's move on even further to the next object, which I have here. You all recognise that, I'm sure. There it is, at home for you. And this is for Dame Twankey, our only woman member here today. And would you pass that, Professor Hart, to Dame Twankey for her to tell me what she makes of that, Dame Twankey?
Yes.
Thank you. Could you just tell us what you think of that?
Ah, yes. Yes. Well, this is obviously a manuscript of some sort.
Yes.
It appears at one time to have been government property. And I would say that it was 17th century Swiss.
Yes.
And it's a novel. Yes, it's a novel. Oh, about China. Yes, it's probably about a prince and princess who get married and live happily ever after in Weston-super-Mare.
Yes. Well, we're quite close. It is, in fact, toilet roll.
Oh, really? May I take it home to read in the Luton train?
Yes, of course you may, certainly. And now we must move on, ever pressing. And we have another object here, which I'd like you to look at very carefully at home. Yes, it's all up on your screens. Now, I'm going to pass this beautiful object to our specialist, who is Dr. Donovan, down the end there. Dr. Donovan,
thank
could you tell me what you think of that?
Yeah. Well, it's really exquisite. Absolutely beautiful. Terribly interesting. Really beautiful. I think I know what it is.
How's that?
Well, you can tell from these very tiny little markings on the underside here, which are almost imperceptible.
Yes.
But of course, the expert can look at these and can determine from these tiny little markings the exact nature and the date of what the object itself is, just from the tiny little markings on the underside here.
I see, very interesting. And what do they say?
They say, this is a British teacup made in Willesden in 1966.
I see. Well, that's where you're wrong.
What?
You see? You think it's ancient Egyptian.
Ancient Egyptian?
Yes, you think yourself so clever. It's ancient Egyptian. It's made in Hong Kong by nude slave labour 64,000 years ago. On the back of a moving Japanese handcart by a Syrian peasant wearing striped purple breeches and a Jewish balaclava. If you know what that is, you know what that is? That's a Latvian barrel organ with twin carburetors. This is a Baltese spittoon. You know what these are? These here, they are Greek hot water bottles. Next week, going through a Burton, we'll be taking a look at the world of art. And in particular, this priceless painting of the Mona Lisa, which has been kindly loaned to us by the French government. So there! Hey!
Hello. Is this your first time in the air, is it?
What?
Is this your first time in the air? I mean, I know we're not in the air yet, but if we were in the air, would this be your first time in the air, would it, eh?
No, I travel across the Atlantic twice a week.
Every week of every year?
Well, for the last 2 years, yes.
Well, on ever. That means means you've been across the Atlantic 104 times. 2 times 52, 104. Isn't that wonderful? Shall I put my safety belt on?
You can if you want to, yes.
I will if you will.
I'm not going to put mine on yet.
Now, come on, it's a game. It's called Who Can Put Their Safety Belt On First?
Look, I've got work to do, do you mind?
Work, yes, that's all right. I've got work to do as well, don't worry.
For God's sake, put it out!
Do beg your pardon.
What's the matter?
You can't use that in here, it'll cause an explosion.
Explosion, yes. Oh dear, don't want explosion doing in an aircraft. No, righto. I think I'll just read.
That would be an excellent idea.
Right. As the shadows lengthened over Bromley, Moira could control herself no longer. She slapped him hard on the upper deck. She slapped him hard. On the upper deck, Mr.
Please,
Figgis
can you keep quiet?
Quiet, yes, quiet, certainly, quiet. You've got an awful lot of hairs up your nose.
Beg your pardon?
I say you've got an awful lot of hairs up your nose.
Do you mind being quiet? There are other people in this plane, you know. There are 74 others, and they don't want to hear your inane chatter all the time.
76 others, 34 on that side, 38 on this side, plus the pilot and the crew and the matron.
Stop it!
Oh, I haven't. That hasn't gone yet.
You won't stop. You won't stop. You're back!
Got your paper bag? You want to go to the ladies' room? Are you all right? Want your paper bag?
Always get the window seat in the end.
A flow of current courses into the motionless metallic form. Happy, don't do it. Don't use full force. What's wrong with me? I'm growing, getting bigger, stronger. I can feel it. Who am I? What? As the electricity's steady flow dries a haze of delirium from Iron Man's mind, and he becomes the freak. Oh, hello. Do you read comics? I do. This week we're doing a number called Beautiful Zelda, and it's about a girl who comes from another planet and she falls in love with an Earth boy, but he doesn't want to know, and so she goes back to the Twilight Zone, but it's not true. And a lot of it's rubbish.
You're wanted in the Twilight Zone now, sir.
Thank you, Rigor.
She's broken all the super hearts of the superheroes of the galaxy. So why does she wanna mess around with me? Listen to my story, it's sad but it's true. Please don't laugh, it could happen to you. Beautiful Zelda from Galaxy 4 suddenly walked through my door. Beautiful Zelda, leave me alone. Just get on back to the Twilight Zone. And don't try your jive on a poor Earth boy, 'cause you're kind of love. Dimensional spacewalk brought her to me. Oh yeah, the most beautiful girl I ever did see. Oh yeah, she gave me her hand, but when I held out, oh yeah, I was fooled by the beautiful Zelda. Beautiful Zelda, tell me the truth. I'm just a clean living all Earth youth. Don't try your jive on a poor Earth boy, 'cause your kind of love don't bring me no joy. Beautiful Zelda. Beautiful Zelda.
Again. Welcome to Beauty Desk. Well, first this week, we have a letter from Mrs. Nora Tremble of Grantham, and she writes, "Thank you for recommending the poison from a deadly viper as a cure for pimples. I drank the whole bottle, and within minutes..." Oh, well, bad luck, Mrs. Tremble. You should, of course, have rubbed it on, not drunk it up. And now it's time for Beauty Desk's Celebrity of the Week. And this week we're very, very privileged to have with us in the studio Monsieur Jacques Chambertin de Flambeau, who has invented a hair restorer which he claims is 100% effective. Monsieur Jacques Chambertin de Flambeau,
C'est un grand plaisir de vous voir aujourd'hui chez Beauty Desk, monsieur.
Oh, thank you very much, Edie. Lovely.
Tell me, have you ever had any failures with your hair restorer?
No, none at all. No, wait a minute, tell a lie. Only Lady Philippa Tidmouth.
Oh, it didn't work on her?
Oh, yes, it worked all right. She took a bath in it and turned into a gorilla.
Tell me, how exactly does your hair restorer work?
Very fast, darling.
Very fast? Well, you must forgive my saying so, but now how do you account for the fact that you yourself haven't tried it?
Oh, I've tried it all right, yeah. But you see, it's so fast I don't get time to put it on my head. See what I mean? Ah! Sorry, I mean, you can't get on
Tonight, on Outrage, we're going to face the Minister of Education with one of his most virulent critics. This programme is live, and viewers are warned that the BBC will not take responsibility for anything said on this show, as it's on ITV. Well, over the last few weeks, there's been mounting criticism of the Minister of Education and the way he's handled the whole switch to the comprehensives. We're very fortunate to have in the studio tonight the Minister of Education. Come in, please. Minister, what in short did you think of your outspoken critic, Mr. William Squatter?
He's a very naughty, naughty, naughty boy.
I see. And have you discussed this in the House? You have. Good. Well, I think at this point we'd better call in Mr. William Squatter, a chairman of the Headmasters' Conference and the former wartime bishop. Come in, please, Mr. Squatter. William. Very well, Priscilla. What do you think of the minister here?
Quack.
I see. Is it real gold?
Quack, quack.
Fine. Well, you've been a very outspoken critic of the minister here. How would you sum up your whole feelings about him?
Quack, quack.
How would you sum up altogether your feelings about him? You think he's made an egg of it?
Yes.
Good. Well, at this moment, I think we need the opinion of a woman, a leading industrialist, an authority on education. Come in, please, Dame Margot Blunt. Dame Margot.
Oh, you could call me Margot, you cheeky little lovely thing. Yes.
Dame Margot, how do you think you've handled the whole switch of vetted questions of the comprehensive?
Oh, well, it's quite easy. Do you know what I'd do? I'd say, look here, children. Look what I've got here. Look, a sprinkling box of chocolates there. I'm going to put them down there. Now, when I turn my back, if anybody touches them chocolates, you shout out, Alan Freeman, all right? Now, you've got it.
Well, the subject tonight has been tense.
Do not worry, Cinders. You shall go to the ball.
Full of straight talk and controversy. Tense and
live. Oh, here they come, my lovely boys. You might see how it moves like that. And this bloody dog goes on.
We shall be back on your screens next week. Until then, it remains for me to say only one thing. Lower the words.
Wait, lower the words. What do you want, sweet?
Thank you.